Right, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Can I welcome you to this, the fourth meeting in 2016 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee? Can I welcome all our witnesses who we'll come to in a moment? Welcome members and welcome guests in the gallery. And can I remind everyone, please, to turn off or at least turn to silent all mobile phones and other electronic devices so they don't interfere with the sound equipment. We have apologies this morning from Patrick Harvey, who has to be elsewhere. Item one on the agenda, can I ask if the members present are content that we take discussions on evidence heard on social enterprises and employee-owned businesses in private at this and future meetings?
Agreed.
Thank you, that is agreed. Item two on the agenda, we are taking evidence this morning on social enterprises, and I'd like to welcome all our witnesses and thank them for attending. This is a follow-up session to a session we had last year when we skimmed the surface on some of the issues around social enterprise, and the purpose of today's session and indeed next week's session is to look at some of these issues in more detail. I think it'd be useful just before we start if we went around the table and we all introduced ourselves and said who we were and which organisation we were from. I'll start and I'll move to Dennis. So my name is Murdo Fraser. I am MSP for Mid Scotland and Fife, and I am the committee convener.
And good morning, I'm Dennis Robertson. I'm the MSP for Aberdeenshire West, and I'm the deputy convener for the committee.
Yes.
Chris Thewlis, GTS Solutions CIC, social enterprise, and here to give evidence. So.
Jake Brodie, one of the MSPs for the South of Scotland, and happily the convener of the Cross Party Group on Social Enterprises.
Ken Milroy, I'm the Chief Executive of Aberdeen Foyer and here to give evidence to the committee.
Gordon MacDonald, MSP for Edinburgh Pentlands.
I'm Brian Weaver, I'm the Chief Executive of HiSES, which is Highlands and Islands Social Enterprise Zone.
Richard Lyle, MSP, Central Scotland.
Good morning, my name is Fraser Kelly, I'm Chief Executive with Social Enterprise Scotland.
I'm Audrey, Carlin. I'm Senior Executive Director of Wasps, which stands for Workshop and Artist Studio Provision Scotland.
Lewis MacDonald, MSP, North East Scotland.
Simon Teasdale, Professor of Public Policy at the Yunus Centre, Glasgow Caledonian University.
Joanne Lamont, MSP for Glasgow Pollock.
Good morning, my name's Lorna Baird. I'm the Social Enterprise Advisor with Business Gateway Edinburgh.
And Joan McAlpine, MSP for the South of Scotland.
Good morning, James McIlroy, Chief Executive of Eurobiotix CIC.
Okay, and then we have the official reporters who are noting down everything you say, and then we have the our clerks here to assist us. Now, we have until about 12 noon for this, so we have a degree of time, but can I ask everybody who's making a contribution if they would keep their remarks as short and to the point as possible? That'd be quite helpful to allow as many voices to be heard as we can. I think what I'll ask members to do perhaps is chip in from time to time with questions or points they want to make, and then if people want to respond to that, if they can just catch my eye and I'll bring you in as best I can as time allows. It would be helpful if somebody makes a point that you are either strongly in agreement with or perhaps more interestingly strongly in disagreement with, that's when we really want to hear from you. So don't be shy about trying to catch my attention and jump in. And I think what we're trying to do this morning is look at a number of areas. We had the presentation in private session earlier on, an informal session in relation to work that's been done in terms of the Social Enterprise Census 2015, which has been very interesting in terms of looking at the scale of the sector. I think we're interested around that, around some of the trends in terms of sector growth, interested in looking at how social enterprises contribute to innovation, interested in issues around funding and if there are issues in accessing funding, and finally, what support is available from public bodies and what more needs to be done from a policy point of view to support the growth of social enterprises. So I wonder if I could maybe just start and maybe direct this question initially to Fraser Kelly, just to allow you to get your thoughts in gear, Fraser, before I fire this at you. But you know, we've heard a bit in terms of the census about the scale of social enterprise in Scotland. Anecdotally, certainly, it would seem to be a story of quite rapid growth in the sector over the last few years. And I'm just wondering if you could give us your take on what the reasons are driving that growth in social enterprise and whether you expect this trend to continue, do you see social enterprises as becoming a more important part of the business and social and economic scene in Scotland over the coming years? And we'll start with Fraser and then maybe get some other views around the table.
Yeah. Thank you, Fergus. Yeah, the census...
Sorry, I should say I'm not Fergus, actually. I'm not being promoted to minister as yet.
Yes, so the census data I mentioned earlier on in my opening remarks was something that we haven't had previously, and it set a baseline for us in terms of where we take social enterprise in the future. Jonathan mentioned that the likelihood was that we would repeat the census in 2 years' time. I think if we repeat the census in 2 years' time and assume that the landscape will have changed without us actually putting policies in place that will make that growth tangible, then simply we will have another census which will say either it has gone up by a couple of thousand or it's gone down by 400 or 500 or a couple of thousand because the marketplace has changed and the conditions in which social enterprises are operating has changed either for the better or for the worse. For our part, we think that there needs to be a promotion of the policy interventions that are already in place. It's things around the Procurement Act. We could be doing more with that. In our view and in our members' view, I think the Procurement Act was an important piece of legislation, but it was almost like we were through on goal and we managed to hit the post because I think it could have gone further. I think the implementation of that in terms of the question four, in terms of what public bodies could be doing and should be doing to encourage those business models, it's about creating opportunities through contracting and commissioning processes. It's about driving the pace of health and social care integration, which, in terms of some of our members, again, appears to them to be moving at the pace of glacial contraction. We could be doing more to create that market opportunity. We've got a question there about assessing the sources of funding and support that are available. And you heard this morning a number of comments around grant funding, and I think we need to move away from the language of funding and talk about funding and investment in social enterprise, because there are a number of emerging models, a number of emerging resources. I don't think it's an absolute shortage of money, but there are organisations who are now entering the market in terms of social investment rather than simply around the grant funding. So yes, I think I mentioned earlier in my remarks before Jonathan Coburn came that I think social enterprise is in a reasonably robust condition. That said, there are some challenges, there are some pressures, as the demand for public services grows, the resources are declining. How do we bridge that gap? The more encouraging data that were included in the census is around consumer-facing social enterprise. Those people are providing goods and services to a public demand, and I think there is perhaps a greater opportunity for us to influence the decision-making of 5.3 million people in the street than there is perhaps the commissioning processes of 32 local authorities. So yes, I think in the round it is reasonably robust, but it needs policy intervention and active implementation of those policies to make it grow.
Okay, thank you for that. A lot of issues you touched on there that I think we'll want to explore over the next little while. I should just say for the record, when Jonathan you referred to was Jonathan Coburn, who gave us a presentation when we were in informal session earlier from what's the name of this organisation? Social Value Lab, that was it, on the census. So when you're referring to Jonathan, that was the Jonathan we were talking about. I want to just stick on this point for the moment now in terms of the growth of the sector and what the future opportunities are. I'm interested to get any other thoughts from around the table from any of our witnesses who might like to contribute to that. Brian, yeah.
The interesting thing again about that research from that Jonathan showed was Highlands and Islands area has 22% of the social enterprises that are operating. And I don't think there's no magic reason for this. And Ms. Lamont came up earlier on with a question in the pre-session as well about how things were changing. The reality for the number of social enterprises in the Highlands and Islands is simply because if you are living in a very small community, nobody else is going to do it for you. If you've only got one autistic boy in the last 25 years, nobody is going to parachute in and deal with that problem for your community. Your community is going to find a way of dealing with it for itself. And I suspect that the rest of Scotland, as the budgets are cut, or as funding goes down, or indeed as funding arrives in different ways,
I think we'll see more and more social enterprises starting simply because people see there is a way that we can solve this problem here, or there's a way that we can deliver something for our community in the way that the Highlands has been now doing for about the last 40 or 50 years.
A very good point, Brian. I was in Glenelg last summer and travelled on
the ferry,
Glenelg Cowrie Ferry, which of course is a community interest company formed by local people to save a vital public transport link which otherwise would have disappeared.
And I'd like to make that point as well. In the Highlands and Islands, it's not just about social care. There's everything from your petrol station to the ferry to the post office to the forest. There's loads and loads of things that communities in the Highlands say, actually, that's what we need. And that's what makes our job really interesting, is that those folk are just running businesses, kind of like yours, James.
Mm. Okay. Check.
I just want to ask any of the guests from the table. It's clear the Highlands and Islands is an exemplar of what can happen. But why is the growth in Glasgow and social enterprises so great?
Part of it.
I don't know if any of the guests have any idea or any suggestion.
Ken.
Yeah. I know in terms of the foyer.
Sorry, Ken, can I just say you don't need to touch any of the buttons? It all operates remotely. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. I know in terms of the foyer's origins, the local authority was critical in helping to bring together the public sector and private interests that were the starting point for the organisation. So I do think local authorities have a key point to play in trying to bring together. Now, that may not be directly the local authority now, maybe through the community planning partnership. I think some of the structures have changed, but the local authority for us was critical in establishing the organisation.
Lorna,
I think here in Edinburgh we have similar growth to Glasgow, and I think one of the reasons in Edinburgh, and I'm speaking specifically about Edinburgh, is that we've got a very much joined up approach in terms of the local authority, Business Gateway, and all the other support agencies. We're definitely working very closely together. We have a strategy that's in place, and we have strategy implementation meetings and to progress that. Now, what that means is that we're all pulling in the one direction rather than operating individually. I think there's more that can be done, but I certainly think in terms of having a strategy, having a very strong social enterprise network, which leads the way and coordinates a lot of activity, is essential in terms of that. But, in terms of my own role, I think what I aim to do is provide that bridge between mainstream support and also specialist social enterprise support, just to ensure that social enterprises who are starting or growing have access to all the resources that are available, not just the very specialist social enterprise ones, because at the end of the day, a social enterprise is a business after all, and we need to be mindful of that, and really it's about pulling all those resources together. But I think key to it is absolutely partnership working. I think that's absolutely critical, and I think that pulling those resources together is essential.
Okay, thank you.
Audrey. I would echo what Lorna has said. WASPS operates across all of Scotland. We work with a large number of local authorities. And in the main, it's not just in response to demand for services that aren't provided by the local authority, but doing something that the local authority perhaps doesn't have the resource or the capacity to do itself, or the expertise in that specialist field. So in our situation, it's bringing old buildings back into use. Quite often, listed buildings or buildings of significant heritage interest. But also ensuring that it's about economic regeneration as well. But we very much rely on working in partnership with those authorities, with those other public bodies, including some of the ones that Lorna mentioned, to achieve what we achieve. And I think the partnership thing is critical, and is something that a lot of social enterprises can't work in isolation. They really have to work to help achieve the objectives of the authorities that they're working in. And I think it's a critical role going forward to make sure that local authorities recognise the impact a social enterprise can have, and that they are working in partnership with them and they can achieve things that they aspire to achieve themselves and to achieve those outputs. We're working with Highlands and Islands Enterprise, we're account managed by Scottish Enterprise as well. So there's a lot of business objectives we seek to achieve, as well as social objectives and our social mission, which is about providing affordable accommodation for artists to allow them to do what they want to do, which is create great pieces of work.
So I'd be a bit careful about the assumption of growth, and particularly rapid growth. I think Jonathan's clear this is the first time the census has been conducted. We don't know what the picture looked like before. He said, you know, he knows from his own work that there's been some growth in Glasgow, but I think, I don't have the figures in front of me, but it's around 5% of all social enterprises were created in the last year, and that's not, that doesn't suggest a picture of rapid growth at all.
Thank you. Thank you for putting that on the record. Dennis.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I wonder, maybe just to explore one aspect, maybe with Ken Milroy here, because the Foyer operates within Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire. And really, I'm just wondering, because it's that area is a perceived affluent area, was there opportunities to set up social enterprises within the supply chain to the oil and gas sector? And if there were, are they currently under threat, or is the current situation in that part of the world providing opportunities for additional social enterprise?
Certainly, working in what is a buoyant or was a buoyant economy, that has most certainly created opportunities that we've taken advantage of. So a number of our trading activities have played to those markets. Our first business, Foyer Graphics, many of our customers that we are delivering graphic design and marketing materials to have come from the oil and gas sector. So we are beginning to see a decline in terms of that trading activity. The other business that we operate is one that we acquired, a driver training school, Roadwise Driver Training. And a large part of its business, again, was with the commercial sector, and a large part with oil and gas companies. And that's about promoting a safe culture in terms of driving to work and supporting employees coming in from other countries. Again, a large part of that trading activity, we've seen a significant decline. So we are being challenged because of that broader economic decline to look at diversifying those business activities, having some success in doing so, I would say. But we saw quite a steep decline in the trading figures for Roadwise because of that oil and gas customer base.
So are there, I think you're alluding to, there may be possible opportunities for additional social enterprise opportunities within that supply chain, or for them to sort of look elsewhere at a different market?
In terms of the Roadwise driver training, I mean, that's one part of the Foyer's portfolio of activities, but we are looking at how we can deliver on larger scale contracts. So while we are regionally focused in our activity, we need to form alliances with similar organisations elsewhere in the country if we want to compete in the markets. So we have recently secured a national contract from a large commercial company, global company, but only because we've formed alliances with other organisations and individuals elsewhere in the UK. So there is the potential for some kind of brokerage arrangement that would allow that to happen more easily. Many of the public sector contracts that we're involved in aspects of our business, they're through, we're part of supply chains, complex supply chains. So I think there are opportunities through those kind of bits of work. But again, helping to broker those kind of arrangements is something that might be considered.
Convener, I wonder if other witnesses, in terms of looking at the local economy of the area, for instance, whether it be Edinburgh or otherwise, how that does impact on the growth of that social enterprise. And Chris here to my right, obviously very diverse in terms of what they're operating within the sort of Edinburgh. And I'm just wondering if the local economy does impact and what you actually choose to set up as a social enterprise.
I don't know whether it's the actual local economy that makes an impact. I think it's a choice on what you want to do above anything else as to regards to as and why you would set up a social enterprise. If you kind of look back towards sort of when you talk about supply chains and collaboration and things like that, I mean, for me, it's very much first and foremost a social enterprise is an enterprise, so it's a business. So, yeah, I mean, collaboration, that is how business is done on many levels. And I think that should be explored a lot more. When we look into sort of public sector work and things like that, supply chains and such forth, we're quite successful in the public sector. We win contracts to deliver our services. On the back of delivering those services, we have surplus funds which we can then reinvest, which is fantastic. Collaboration deals, yeah, it should be able to be done through public procurement and such forth for smaller social enterprises. But first and foremost, I think when we talk about public sector work and such forth, we need to educate the people that are in the public sector. Unfortunately, procurement officers don't really understand things like social benefits and such forth. They think they do, they kind of hope they do, and they have their own idea of what they are, but it's not actually what they really are. So there's a little bit of education piece there to be done on that.
That's a really quite interesting point you just raised, Chris, about procurement. I'm interested to get anybody else around the table's experience of the procurement process, because a lot of social enterprises will be hoping to win public sector contracts. So has anybody else got any perspective on that? Yes, James.
Hello. I have experience in trying, well, with NHS procurement, and I found it to be very disparate and very difficult indeed, because each NHS Trust in Scotland seems to run independently, and in general it's quite difficult to get to speak to the people you want to speak to. I don't know if anyone else has had a similar experience around this table, but I do believe that MSP involvement could make that process much easier, especially when you have a highly scalable social innovation that could genuinely impact on thousands of people in Scotland, and that should really be scaled out as quickly as possible.
Okay, thanks. Ken?
A large part of our business activity is through public sector contracts. So something like 90% of our work is through trading activity, and 70% of that is through public sector contract work. So we've quite a diverse experience of dealing with different public bodies, and some of the issues that we're facing and have continued to face are the short-term nature of procurement. So we're still seeing one-year contracts for what are ongoing and much-needed services, most notably in employability, and that activity won't be ceasing. So I do think there is an issue around short-termism. I think the other aspect is we've seen some social enterprises squeezed out of markets because of large-scale procurement, and that, I think, becomes problematic. Lorna mentioned the local strategies that can be put in place through local authorities and other organisations collaborating. That can help smaller social enterprises enter into those markets. So large-scale public procurement has been problematic, and I certainly have seen quite a shift over the years that we've been operating towards large-scale procurement. The disadvantage of that is it squeezes out some innovative players.
Okay. Chris, you want to come back in?
When you say large-scale public procurement, what are you kind of aiming at? Are you aiming at sort of like million plus, such forth?
The areas of work that we're involved in are DWP contracts. So now, generally, we are part of the supply chain arrangements with large-scale contractors. Previously, we had direct relationships with DWP. I think given the devolution of that aspect of activity to Scotland, there's opportunity to look at the procurement that will go alongside any new employability activity. And I think to build on what we've got at a local level rather than take a top-down approach would be helpful.
Okay. Lewis first and then John.
It was really just to follow up that point and to ask whether that's an experience that is general, because I've certainly come across that in relation to quite a range of different contracts, and I wonder just how much it's impacting on the social enterprise sector. So, for example, the hub model for procuring significant infrastructure investment in Scotland is typically done on the basis of large-scale contracts. Is that something that's affected social enterprises around the table or others of which, you know, and I know one or two of our guests may have an input on that.
Fraser.
There is an issue in terms of the where social enterprise can participate in that supply chain and whether they are employability, I think, is a slightly different part from the hub approach. We know that in employability, social enterprises can meet performance standards. We know they meet quality thresholds. We know they meet financial capability and viability assessments. Where we can't compete is on price. And when contracts are simply driven by price and on discounts, and if that's the large national framework contracts that you're talking about, Ken, then there is a huge challenge for social enterprise participating anywhere other than in the lower ends of the supply chain. In terms of hub contracts and the large infrastructure projects, we have, over a long number of years, worked on community benefit clauses. Many of them are implemented by larger contractors under a best endeavours approach. Some of them are more embedded. Those organisations like McAlpines, etc., who have a more creative approach to building their supply chain with social enterprises are certainly very good examples. But I think there is a challenge in terms of applying or obliging those contracts to include community benefit clauses, which are in some ways arbitrary, rather than asking the owners of those contracts to include social enterprises as part of the supply chain, and in actual fact put targets within that to whether it be by value or whether it be by scale in terms of social enterprise participation, rather than the traditional CBCs that we've seen previously.
So at the moment, I think what you're saying is that the best of the large contractors will choose or will implement a community benefit that's meaningful and that creates business opportunities, but they're not obliged to. And the way that the contracts are procured is too permissive in that sense and allows them not to do so if they don't want to.
Too permissive in terms of the scoring of the social impact element of those contracts. It's a very, very small part of the contract assessment process. And again, whether the contract actually is, whether the costs of the community benefit clauses are then reintroduced to the contract in another way, or indeed whether those community benefits are actually delivered upon over time.
And I wonder if Ken Milroy would want to add in relation to the DWP model, given the importance of that for its future devolution, whether the same points apply there. In other words, you're taking part as part of the supply chain, but is the way that those contracts are being let now supportive or unsupportive of engagement with social enterprises like yourself?
For us, it's very problematic. That we run a number of contracts in that area. They will come to an end at the end of March. And at this point in time, I'm not sure what is going to fill that gap for our area. We've seen unemployment statistics soar for the North East. And in terms of the mainstream programmes through DWP and indeed through Skills Development Scotland, to what extent will they take into account the very sharp rise in unemployment that we are currently seeing? Perhaps wasn't on the stats 6 months ago or a year, but it's certainly showing now.
Thanks.
Sorry, Joan, I think first.
Just to go back again to the procurement issue, Fraser mentioned the procurement bill. Is there enough use being made of the measures in the procurement bill? Like procurement officers in local authorities confident enough to use the legislation that's there?
Chris?
I think you'll find absolutely not, is the answer. They don't really understand what's gone on. They don't understand things like community benefits, such as they would like to think to do, they would like to think they have a way with all of it, but they're, the majority of the procurement officers up and down the 32 local authorities believe that community benefit are the things that larger companies can do for free. That won't cost them anything more on top of the actual cost of the service.
So do you think more could be done with the legislation that's already been passed?
More could be done with the legislation that's already been passed. More could be done to educate the people that are actually procuring the contracts so that they have an understanding of what's out there and what value can be added.
Fraser.
I think there's another side to the equation. The procurement legislation I mentioned, I think we hit the post rather than scored the goal. Yes, it could be better implemented, but there is still a challenge, and you know, the commissioning officers are one part of the equation. The directors of finance and legal services within public bodies are another part of the equation, and they do find it difficult to equate the social impact which social enterprise is delivering with a positive net present value that equates to a price consideration. And I think there's a difficulty in getting that understanding through to the commissioners in a way that they can describe this will be achieved and the preventative spend outcome is that, and we can actually apply it to a contract value which is that. And we need to find better within the social enterprise arena a way of describing what the social impact is in terms of a net present value that the financial modelling understands, because I think we've got a bit of disparity there. People are all, you know, money drives behaviour.
Yeah. And can you just ask, in your experience of the public sector in Scotland, you know, where is that lack of education most acutely noticed? Is it in local authorities, or is it are there other public bodies that are doing it better than others, for example?
We don't have empirical evidence or data that suggests either or. I think there's a general feeling that the legislation could be, in some cases it may be self-selected not to pursue the legislation, in others it's just simply poor understanding of it. I suppose the challenges are for us to make sure that there is a, when we talk about consortia, when we talk about joint ventures, when we talk about that contracting model, it's very difficult when sometimes, you know, DWP over a number of years, Ken, have described what they would like in terms of the framework contracts. They've glibly described things like, we would like to see the third sector and social enterprise delivering more of the employability, more in the employability arena. They describe special purpose vehicles, but they don't actually know what that means. And when you test these approaches, it very, very quickly falls apart. So you spend an inordinate amount of time designing the programme of work that you think will fit the pre-qualifying questionnaire and then invitation to tender processes, simply to get to a hurdle where it's a price-based contract. So there's a big challenge for us, I think, to understand better, does that rhetoric of having social enterprise in the third sector delivering more of the public service arena equate to the reality of this is how the process will work and engage you in it?
Right.
Can you see how irrelevant this is to 22% of the social enterprises in Scotland, the ones that are in Highlands and Islands Enterprise that area? They have no idea of how any of these big contracts work. They are small local social enterprises and they cannot get involved in these multi-million pound contracts. Every now and again, the suggestion is that the way forward is for us to get into consortia to bid for those contracts. And then you have this really very specific problem of how do you decide which is going to be the winning consortium? And we found ourselves in that. We were in a contract once, which when it came to an end, was replaced effectively by a Scottish Government contract. So instead of us being able to, HISA being able to bid for this particular piece of work, we had to decide to join a consortium. And in 10 minutes, we had to decide which was the consortium that was going to win and put all our work into that one. And then the Scottish Government took, you know, months and months and months to actually decide that that was going to be the winning consortium. It creates a real problem for people who are trying to run ordinary small businesses all the time. And the answer is to make it simple. Give the power to the procurement officers to procure small amounts. Actually force them. If you've got £1 million contract, have 10 £100,000 contracts and have, you know, 100 £10,000 contracts. That's how you'll get your, you know, centralised money down. Otherwise, if your contracts continue to get bigger and bigger, you will just get more PA consultings and more Ernst. You know, you'll get all the multinationals coming into it. Go for small contracts, and you'll get it right down to the roots where you want it to be, and you'll get local people delivering the services that the locality needs. Thank you for nodding, Lorna. You know what it's like.
Okay, thanks. Gordon, you're keen to come in.
Thanks. Just to take that point you've raised, Brian, about obviously giving more trading opportunities to social enterprises, I was wanting to ask you about some of your written evidence. This morning we heard that grant funding is important to social enterprise organisations, and the stats say that 31.5%, excluding housing associations and credit unions, are dependent on grant funding. And in your written evidence, you said there's no shortage of funds available to the sector. Grants themselves lead to problems, and grants also have a direct effect on the application process. And you referred to something called the Binbecula principle.
Oh dear.
So I'm just wondering if you could maybe expand on some of that. Oh. You know?
We've been going out into the community for 7-8 years now. I've been doing it, giving business advice and helping local folk to run their social enterprises. And I come from a commercial background, so I kind of understand how people do it commercially. And yet when you're talking to people and there's grants in the background, it kind of distorts the way that they think. So we did this experiment, and it was done in an event in Benbecula, where we came up with the costs to actually deliver a particular output. And we separated them into two groups, and we said to one group, here's an opportunity for you to get into a business. You can apply for some money, and it will be a contract, and you'll be able to make money out of that in the future. Given that your costs are going to be £9,000, how much cash do you think you'll need in order to get going in this business? And in the other one, we said, you need £9,000, there's grants available. How much would you apply for? It's all grants. In this one, it's all business. There's a bit of competition from other places. And we did it kind of lightheartedly, and the figures came back straight away. In one case, they came up with sort of £13,000, I think, that they needed for the £9,000 grant. They were asking for 13. And in the other one, where they knew it was going to be a business, they only asked for 6,000. So because there had been a grant available, they had asked for more. And we kept running this, and we keep running it. And every time we ask, and the figure's getting wider and wider apart, when you tell them that it's a business that they're going or a contract they're going for, they will ask for less. When they know there's a grant, they will ask for more. And we have bitter experience of this ourselves. High Size at one stage decided that we would build on the University of the Highlands and Islands new campus. We were interested in building a centre for social enterprise practice. And we went to our board and said, we can do this from scratch. We can borrow the money. We've already borrowed money from the Royal Bank. We could do this again. And our board said, oh no, this needs you to go out there and investigate grants. So we started looking for grants. And as soon as we started speaking to grant funders, they all wanted it to be bigger. We wanted a £400,000 building. We could maybe go to £500,000. The funders, without exception, said, oh, you should be far more ambitious than that. So grants enable social enterprises to have somebody else's ambition. And that's a scary direction to go in.
I'm just wondering, is that because they generally give less than you ask for? Because they've got this mindset that if you're applying for, say, 13,000, you're only going to get 9.
Absolutely. The whole thing, and I'm sure that the researchers have looked at this, it develops a whole mindset that becomes self-defeating.
Yeah. Interesting. James.
Yeah, I mean, this might be slightly controversial, but I think this grant dependency culture that we have within the social enterprise network in Scotland is pretty toxic. Because one has to ask themselves what happens when the grants go away. The whole thing collapses. We should be promoting investment and sustainable businesses that are profitable. And that's a very important point that I'd like to open to the floor.
Okay. John, do you want to come in on this point?
Yeah. Does that mean, therefore, that there are some services that should not be social enterprises? I'm interested in this question of substitution. It's something that's delivered as a service, a support to somebody with a learning disability, somebody with autism, should that really be something that we have to find a way of making a profit out of, or do you simply recognise there are some things for which the state should pay? And I actually am very much in favour of the third sector delivering some of these, because if you get a family with a child with a learning disability, they know better what that service should look like than somebody sitting 100 miles away. But it shouldn't be. These are different And I think two things are getting conflated, which is, on one hand, services, which, because local authorities have no money, the way they can get the best bang for their buck is to get people to fight over the bit of money, or there are social enterprises. I mean, I'm very much in favour of the cooperative model. The cooperative model says there has to be democratic accountability and it has to work financially and it shouldn't rely on grant at all. And I think, I wonder if the question that you're asking means that these two things are being brought together, when in fact we should maybe be looking at how we take them apart a bit. Because I am concerned you're seeing some organisations being expected to go out to create social enterprise for a service which simply in a decent society should be provided. And we need to think about how best that can be done closest to those that need it.
Mm-hmm. Chris?
I think when we're talking about that, is it not important to say that the social aims and objectives should be that service? Yeah? And that social aim and objective that is that service, that should be delivered from the profit made by the enterprise. Not the enterprise delivers that service.
We don't apply that rule in the National Health Service.
But we
don't apply that rule. What we start with in the National Health Service is providing for need. Now, I think there are some things from which you can make a surplus, which can then, I mean, housing is a good example. And I'm very much in favour of community-based housing associations. I'm not sure if the idea of investment and so on really applies to meeting the needs of a family with a child or a learning disability. I don't think these things are comparable.
That's not essentially what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, and I think that James will probably agree here, when we talk about investment and such forth, that's for the enterprise, yeah? The profit that is made from the enterprise should fulfil the social end of objectives, and the social end of objectives, I think, is what you're talking about. And that's the whole idea. Make the money, then spend it on those social end of objectives, not make those social end of objectives the way you make the money.
Okay. Lorna.
I'd like to make the point, you know, social enterprises working in that sort of health and social care sector actually bring innovation to services, and I agree there are certain services that should be a standard that should be provided, but I was involved in a social enterprise called My Enterprise, who provided support for people who had learning disabilities to set up their own small micro enterprise. Now, how they operated was very much in a membership model, but it was to use or to access self-directed support that allowed that enterprise to be sustained. So, you know, it wasn't the profit or the generating of income. Profit was to sustain and grow that enterprise so that it can reach more individuals. And I think that that's the key to, in terms of social enterprise, is that the profit is not a bad word. It actually allows you to achieve greater scale and greater scope. And I think that and innovation, a local authority would never have provided that type of support. It actually came from an innovation of a social entrepreneur.
I agree absolutely with that. The best examples of change have come from the voluntary sector, the third sector, from families, from communities. You know, island and rural communities have been doing it for hundreds of years. I'd simply ask the question that there is some evidence, for example, that social enterprises are quitting the field in care because the costs have been driven down. So it's not about there is X amount of money available to support and how is the model for delivering it. It is actually people are saying, no, we're getting out of here because the costs are prohibitive, and the private sector is stepping in with a far poorer quality service, I would argue, in some of these. And I wonder whether we're expecting, well, it's like, by the very nature of the sector, if you try to define it too much, you lose what its energy is. And I wonder if we're trying to get too broad a scope from actually, you know, like, for example, in my own community, a very good community transport service. And it's self-starting and it gets bits of grants and monies and so on. But what the very heart of it is a community that says we want to get elderly people to the hospital to visit their relatives. And it's as simple as that. If you analyse it too much, you lose it. And I think that's very different from some of the big social enterprise models who are doing fantastic. They're doing business better than perhaps you could argue would have been done otherwise.
Simon?
I think I'd agree with a lot of that. So, yeah, the social enterprise covers a wide variety of organisations. Some will always require grants, other types of organisations will be able to be profitable and plough the surplus back, but if we start worrying about grant dependency, there's a worry that organisations only do things that are profitable, and there's some things in life that we just can't make a profit out of.
Lewis?
Yeah, I wanted, I guess, to come back to James and his point, because we've met and spoken before, and I know a little bit about the project, but that underlies his the social enterprise he's involved in. But can he tell us what the rationale or the basis for decision making was in his case to go down the social enterprise route, where clearly many other university spin-outs would go down a much more directly commercial route, and perhaps understand a bit better the motivation or the direction of travel of his firm?
Yeah, I mean, this is a question we get asked all the time, most often by investors, actually. It's the first thing they say. Oh, it's a really interesting business proposition you have. It could be quite profitable. Why are you a CIC? It's the first question we get asked every time. And the reason primarily is, as one of the founders of this company and as a future healthcare professional, we wanted to deliver this service to the NHS at as close to a cost recovery basis as possible, to not be a financial burden, and to support the organisation that I would argue is probably the greatest social innovation in the history of the UK. And if I was to ever lose control of this organisation, i.e. not be the CEO or not be a director, then whoever was the director would have to maintain those community interests. And that is regulated by the CIC regulator. We also have the asset lock, and we also have a dividend cap. Which brings me on quite nicely to the next thing, which is a voluntary code for social enterprises. And I made a point of this in my written evidence. And there are some people that don't believe that a CIC limited by shares is a social enterprise because it's limited by shares. But I would argue that inherently it has to be. Because it's regulated by the CIC regulator, it has community objectives, and there is a dividend cap and an asset lock. Furthermore, it can also be quite an attractive proposition for investors, and we need to, as a collective, promote that. Because it's a really interesting business model, and I'm determined to be the first biotechnology CIC that I'm aware of to make it to first sale and to scale. So, there we go.
And it's the attractiveness of the business to investors is, do you think, enhanced rather than limited by the fact that it's not a conventional commercial business?
I think that it is slightly hindered, of course, because of the dividend cap. But, you know, transfer business, they still retain full value. So in the event of an acquisition, they would still make a return on investment. However, it's incomparable to a company limited by guarantee that can't take on any equity investment whatsoever and would be, and I don't think it would go anywhere, especially in the biotechnology and healthcare sectors, because a significant part of these companies is research and development. And it takes a long time to get to market. And it requires committed investors, not people that are going to commit to a company without any shares. So I think it is. And also, actually, I'd say that when we approach healthcare professionals, being a social enterprise really has helped us, because we can see eye to eye. And if we were a purely for-profit entity, I think it would be much more difficult to us for us to have received the sort of support we have received, which has been fantastic.
I'd like to take up James's point about the voluntary code of practice and the fact that community interest companies by shares aren't recognised. In my experience working with startup social enterprises or social entrepreneurs, there's a much more leaning towards community interest companies by shares, and it's not led by profit. Let me assure you, it is not about profit that these individuals are setting up kicks by shares. They are setting up kick by shares because it allows them control over their organisation that they've set up and invested their time, their energy, and often their own personal money in the organisation. And so what I'd say is that social entrepreneurs are setting up community interest companies are 100% committed to that social impact that they are trying to achieve, and that really what they're trying to do is secure their position within their own company longer term. Because if they adopted a limited by guarantee model, technically, if they fell out with the board, they could be kicked out their own company. Now, you can understand why social entrepreneurs, and that is the majority in Edinburgh, and it's individuals who are setting up businesses to address a particular social need, and they're driven to address that, and they're adopting different models and very innovative new models as well. Again, the kick by shares is something that's been adopted in England, but certainly less so in Scotland. But I've certainly seen over the last 2 years a much more focus on that. And again, from an investment point of view, is you know, there's certain organisations that, yes, are very much suited to limited by guarantee, and I would say a community-based social enterprise, that may be applicable, or a social enterprise that's been developed by a charity, an arm of a charity, absolutely. But when you're talking about individuals setting up social enterprises, they want control, and if they want to scale and have ambition, they also need to look for investment. And it's interesting that Social Investment Scotland are now investing in kicks by shares. So, you know, there is change in the scene, which is really encouraging, because we won't get the scale and the growth in social enterprise without the investment. And if we want to move away from this grant dependency, then we really need to be thinking, well, it's investment that we need to go for, and it's in every form of investment, because there are individuals out there in the angel sector who are very interested in social impact and achieving social benefits, and they want ways of being able to invest, and that's, it can be done through a shares model.
Okay. Joan, you were keen to come in a moment ago. Was it on the same point?
Yeah, it was just kind of to go back to the point that Joanne made. And I think it's an important question that a lot of people will ask, you know, like, how can you deliver services and also take a profit? Certain services. And I just wondered whether, and this question may is partly been answered, but in my experience, sometimes public bodies, there is quite a lot of, you know, like top-heavy bureaucracy. And is there any, you know, like evidence that's been taken that you can actually deliver the same service plus the, you know, the redistributed profits, probably for less money, so that you can actually deliver a better service because of that kind of top-heavy bureaucracy that you see in some public sector organisations.
Ken, did you want to come in?
Yeah, really interesting comments, and just to hear a bit more about the business model. But I guess I would just caution that there is merit in us being a broad church. There is merit in the diversity. And having a policy framework that goes down a particular route, I think we'd be flawed. I think it needs to be broad-based if it's going to keep everybody in the tent, and I think we should be trying to keep everybody in the tent. So I do think we need to be careful that we don't put all our eggs in one basket. I think that is a fantastic business model, and we'd want to encourage it, but I would also want to encourage those very small community-based enterprises, because that may not be the right model for them.
Fraser.
I could to sort of square the circle of this a little bit. If you look at page 15 of the census, sorry, if you don't all have it, there's one of the pieces of data that's there that suggests that 82% of our social enterprise and community enterprise activity is operating outside of the worst 20% of enumeration districts in Scotland when you look at the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation. That suggests that only 20% are operating inside those areas. The rationale of social enterprise, and many of our members that we speak with will tell us that they are working with the people who are hardest to reach and working in the most disadvantaged communities. And you remember in my opening remarks, I made a distinction between fragile communities, which I think Brian describes very well in Highlands and Islands, and disadvantaged communities, which are in the urban areas. Joanne has mentioned this morning the role of housing associations and RSLs. There's a really strong... Jonathan made a comment about let's take housing associations out of the equation because it distorts the picture a little bit. Housing associations are fundamentally asset-led. The assets that they have were transferred through a community asset transfer process.
They're locally owned and locally controlled, and they're governed. They have deals to die for when it comes to investment-led processes, and they operate in our most disadvantaged communities. What we should be trying to aspire to is to have the rest of the social enterprise scene and economy brought up to that scale. We've asked again, what can public bodies do more to facilitate that? The Community Empowerment Bill, asset transfer. When organisations have an asset on their balance sheet, it makes them much more capable of bidding for a public service contract or doing any other form of business, as Brian has described, because it's investable. The investment flows to it much more quickly. If it has an asset, it flows to it much more quickly if it has a contracting framework. And Lorna's right, we're seeing much more social investment coming to the table. These things need to be squared, and the pieces of the jigsaw are there. I think we just don't have the lid at the moment. For me, the housing association model and the route that that has gone down is part of that lid. What James has described is the other part of it. And this is an inclusive and broad-based approach. But there are ways that we need to put in place the things that we've already established to make this work more effectively.
Okay. Conversation stopper. The person who caught my eye was Chick, actually. Chick.
Yeah, basically, I agree with what Fraser said. I mean, it clearly, there are already dynamics in the whole landscape of social enterprise that can formulate, you know, the production of more and more social enterprises and the development of existing ones. I think one of the things that I like, and I was listening to James about, you know, the large companies that chase profits unlimited eventually, I believe, die. They fall on their own swords or their own profits. And many of the social enterprises and those that lead them that I've met certainly have the profit motive as an intent. But interestingly, the characteristic is the dedication primarily to the social involvement of their enterprise. I think one of the other things that we need to consider, because of the involvement and the participation of people who work in the social enterprises, is the change in productivity is quite marked. And it comes back to the public procurement issue in terms of looking at that. The value add generally through social enterprise is substantially greater than saying, oh, we have to do it internally. That partnership between the public enterprise and the social enterprise can be very productive both to the customers and to the employees and those in the social enterprises.
Richard, you're going to make a point?
Yeah, actually, two convenient. Thanks very much. Chris Thewlis, in your submission, and maybe we can get other comments from people. And I'll quote, "It's unfair to say that the Scottish Government isn't doing enough to encourage social enterprise, but we can say that the Scottish Government isn't doing the right things to encourage the growth and sustainability of social enterprise business models." So what should the Scottish Government be doing?
I think if you move a bit further down the paper, it goes into that a little bit more, but there is such forth as we talk a lot about getting into public procurement. We don't educate the people, the buyers within public procurement, to understand what happens within social enterprise, and we don't do that to the point that I've come across procurement officers that don't understand what a kick is at all. You know, that's not a formation of a company, so we've refused your tender, you know. There's a big piece about educating these people within these sectors. There's a big piece about joining people within the public areas, so within local authorities together. So you have a piece that's, there's a big employability piece within every local authority. There's people that do procurement. Do these people speak to these people? Probably not. So do these people see that there is a value in that contract with a social enterprise that also delivers employability from its profitability, which could be passed across, which could help the local authority at this point? Definitely not. You know, it's more about education than anything else. You know, we're doing good things, you know, we are, but I think there's more that can be done internally so that more local authorities understand a little bit more of what social enterprise is trying to achieve.
I totally agree with you. I was a councillor for 36 years and dealt with officers and the point that Brian made earlier about smaller contracts. I actually introduced a company to the officer, and it saved the council a quarter of a million pounds. you know, because they've done something different. And I agree with the points that you're making. If no one has any other thing, the other one that's jumping out at me is that among the many things you're going to have to face, you're going to have to face, we're all in the pension situation. Everybody has to have a pension. So are companies gearing up for that? Will small companies be able to gear it? And I believe that one of the submissions, again, says that the Scottish Government should investigate the central provision of pensions for everyone in the sector, and also, you know, to ensure that, that everybody's getting a pension. So what do you think about the we're all in situation that you'll have to be in this year to give your workers pensions?
Well, Chris, I think we're all already in. The majority of us already pay the living wage. Hopefully more become accredited to prove that they are paying a living wage. And on top of that, the pension is it's a minimal extra cost, I think. I think we are all in, but I think it's quite important that if we're going to commit to all of these things, that perhaps it should be noted that we are committing to these things, because that is quite a downfall when it comes to competing for costs and such forth in contracts. Because you're paying the living wage, your margins have to be a little bit tighter, a little bit smaller. We're all in the pension, margins are going to get a bit tighter again. You know, so I think maybe, potentially, possibly, I mean, I keep coming back to public procurement, I know, but it's a great example for these sort of things. There should be some form of point scoring on a tender process that says, yes, we pay the living wage. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we do. Yeah, we pay this pension. But we don't. Maybe we don't just pay the basic pension. Maybe we pay a little bit more, and that gets a few more points. And maybe that will force the private sector to follow suit.
And just to finish off, Convener James McIlroy, earlier on you made a comment that get your local MSP behind you when you want. And you know, the point is that there are politicians who do have, you know, you can speak to officials to get. The one problem that used to annoy me intensely was the fact that small companies couldn't get to see someone and just couldn't get by the door. And it was the same old companies. Oh, we've dealt with you for years, you know, so we'll just keep dealing. But they were charging the council a fortune. But whereas the other people who came in were prepared to be more innovative, the point that Joanne Lamont made earlier on, in order to ensure that, you know, it was a local situation. And a company, an organisation I also dealt with, APSE, the Association of Public Service Excellence, who are based in Manchester, who run for companies, for councils, produced a paper a number of years ago that for every pound was spent locally, actually generated £1.60 in the local economy. So I'd be more than happy, if you have any problems in my area, to get the to give you a hand. And I'm sure if companies want to talk to... Sometimes I feel you don't talk to politicians enough. Round tables, yes, but you don't locally go and visit. You know, they have surgeries, they have offices. Go and see them, talk to them, get involved, and then we'll all work together. So I'll be more than happy to help you if you're ever out Motherwell way.
Okay, George.
Fraser Kelly made about only 20% of social enterprises operate in the poorest, most disadvantaged communities. I understand, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, there is some evidence that in poorer communities, working class communities, the one I came from, people didn't expect to run their own businesses. But in fact, they're more likely to be involved in a social enterprise than setting up their own business. So there's an economic argument, both in terms of stimulating economic activity locally and within disadvantaged communities, of creating social enterprise. So how should those who have got the responsibility for this direct some energy towards creating social enterprises where, again, you know, the impact in terms of employment, more likely to set up business, so on, is most evident? What needs to be done to support that?
Fraser?
Something very clear that we can shift our emphasis, Joanne, and it's to put the individual in all of our communities at the heart of every decision that we make. There have been a number of activities over a long number of years of trying to spatially target
big lumps of money. When I arrived in Castlemilk, I came at the end of the New Life for Urban Scotland monies, £280 million pumped into the housing, did a lot with the housing but didn't do anything with the people. We've gone through enterprise zones, urban regeneration companies, business improvement districts. We're now on city region deals. We've gone through areas of priority treatment, priority partnership areas, social inclusion partnership areas, now in community planning partnership areas. And all of these are structures. They're not about the individual people. And when people challenge me about that, they say, but the characteristics of each individual is so different, it's very difficult to design a universal service. Our services should not be designed on a universal basis. They should be designed on the basis of the needs of the individual, and that individual can come into a service provision at whatever stage they are in their requirement, and that we measure the distance that they travel and the outcome is what change has actually happened. And it's not necessarily that the outcome is a job, which is usually the payment by results model that is designed and delivered within the public sector. That's why we're seeing so many more social enterprises actually delivering goods and services to consumers and using then the resources that they generate from that to work with a group of individuals. If I were to ask everybody in here to go for a coffee with me now, how many people would like to go to Costa, where they have said that they will transfer the cost of the living wage onto the price of your coffee? Or how many people would like to come round the corner to Serenity Cafe, where they're repatriating every piece of their profits back into working with people who are on a recovery journey from addictions? That's the choice that we have to make. It's about putting the individual at the heart of every decision we make, whether it be ourselves, or whether it be public bodies, or whether it be the private sector.
We have to do to make that happen. I mean, actually, I'm not sure if I agree with you around social inclusion partnerships. I think as time has moved on, we've moved away from it. We have social enterprise which doesn't have any responsibility for people or place any longer, although HIE does. And we've moved from a very locally based social inclusion partnership to community planning, which is for everybody, and it's much more centralised, and the community and individual involvement as such is much more limited. But how do you transfer that aspiration to actually policy decisions around stimulating social enterprise development within poorer communities?
I wasn't suggesting that community planning was a better part of the process. I was just suggesting that every 3 years or 5 years we seem to get to a stage where
they were all rubbish in terms of dealing with individuals. Now, they might not have been massively effective, but I think some of them did actually, I mean, particularly around social inclusion, had a big focus on individuals and communities and working with and putting them into the structures. And the whole bend to spend monies around budgets and so on probably was never properly delivered, but at least it was a policy aspiration, which I think we've shifted from now.
I agree with you, but the difficulty is that we change them every 3 years, and there is an assumption that that's not working because we haven't got an evidence base that there's been a material change. And if you take things like the SIMD, we could potentially have a situation where if you're working in employability, you have a reduction in the number of people who are employment deprived, but an increase in the number of people who are income deprived. The policymakers can't seem to understand that, and they can't make sense of it, so they move the things again. For me, there are ways to do this, and it's about giving that accountability back to local people. I come back to the issue about housing associations. They are anchor organisations. They are locally owned and locally controlled by people. They understand what the needs are of the local communities. We're seeing a number of housing associations becoming more active in social enterprise activity. We're seeing a number who are stepping away from it. And some of that's about the regulatory framework, because any subsidiary activity that has the potential to impact negatively on the core housing business is seen as quite risky. But I think that's the areas where we need to develop locally owned, locally controlled, using those anchor organisations to develop local capacity within some of the most disadvantaged areas that we have.
Brian.
From our experience in the Highlands, I think it's impossible to come up with a blanket solution here. Do you know what? It's people that make a difference. And you can't even choose, you can't say, oh, you have to make the difference. What we are finding is that in a community, if somebody comes up and says, you know what, here's what we can do, it's that person who says, you know what, you know, and you've got them in this room. It's those individuals. You have to find a way of backing those individuals. Now, I made the comment about the pensions because
My concern in our small social enterprises is that we've got those individuals and they invariably have a board round about them who are very supportive. But we are expecting inexperienced, unpaid people to actively become the operators of fairly substantial businesses in a fairly short time. So you can have somebody who says, there's no post office, you know, or the petrol station is about to be shut, we better do something about it. And that person drives the way through, gets the money, buys the petrol station, gets the staff in, trains the staff, delivers the petrol, makes the profit and everything else. And you've got a volunteer director standing beside them who have never done this before. And we expect them to go from nowhere to being able to run a £1 million business. And then we expect them to know that, you're not a charity anymore, so your business stream water is going to cost you a lot more than you ever thought it was going to cost you. And have you realised that you're going to have to deal with pensions this year? We're enterprise is about running a business. The social part you write down beforehand and you deliver on a yearly basis. But the enterprise thing is the day-to-day, how do you run the business? And with due respect, committees don't run businesses. Individuals like James and Isabel and Ingrid and Duncan and Christine, all people that I've seen in the last month, those are the people who run the businesses. Those are the people who run the enterprises. Those are the people who run the social enterprises. Find those folk and support those folk rather than trying to support an institution.
Okay. Dennis.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. It's really kind of following on from what Brian's just touched on and some other witnesses, but what I'm interested in is, where's the information at the beginning, the start-up? I mean, if I decided to set up a social enterprise, you know, who do I speak to? Who do I go to? Who's got the right information? Who can guide me? Who can actually put all the factors that you've just mentioned, Brian, in place for me? And how to take my idea, my proposal forward. So where do I go to? How is that information actually gained? Are the right people providing that information? And I'm wondering maybe from Simon's perspective as well, what do we need in terms of information for the future? We've got a snapshot in time here, but what do we actually need to collate to make it meaningful so we understand not just where we are, but where we should be?
Simon.
In terms of the information we need, we need to repeat the survey in pretty much exactly the same way every 2 years for the next 10 years. And there needs to be commitment to the investment in that. It's expensive. And from that, to be able to understand not just the overall growth, but different changes within the sector, how more types of certain organisations are coming through, other types of organisations are disappearing, and begin to get a picture that way.
Mm-hmm. Okay. James?
Richard, I have had support from Maureen Watt and Lewis McDonald in my area, so thought it would be good to get that in there. Dennis, you asked about who you would seek advice from if you were a social entrepreneur wanting to start a social enterprise. So, 14 months ago, I started a social enterprise, so I think I'm reasonably well placed to answer that question. And the answer depends on where you live. And this is true because there's a number of different organisations that deliver different kinds of advice. We've been very lucky in the sense that some people deem our social enterprise to have the potential to be very sort of financially successful. So we've had support from Scottish Enterprise through a unit called the High Growth Startup Unit, which has been excellent, I must add. We've also had support from Firstport Scotland. We've also had support from an Enterprise Campus Initiative at Aberdeen University, which Lewis knows about. I've also had support as a graduate from Edinburgh University from Launch.ed, and have had support from all the business competitions that we've entered and subsequently won. So I suppose it kind of depends on how successful you are in business competitions, and it depends on where you're located. I've also had support from Lorna, even though we're not based in Edinburgh, and she's very good, so we need more Lornas in business gateways. No, this is true. This is true. I'm not just saying that because she's here. She's been excellent. And we do need more people like Lorna who have expertise in starting up social enterprises. In Aberdeen, I don't know if there really are many people that have expertise in starting up social enterprises in the advice centres that we have, for example, Elevator. I also know that the university support centres that we have, Enterprise Campus, Launch.ed, don't have, you know, specialist people to give advice for social enterprises. So maybe we need a social enterprise MSP that, you know, organises a group of experts And that can be transferred through these organisations that I've spoken about. So people like myself who want to start social enterprises and people who really genuinely do want to make a difference to society can get the advice they need when they start.
So does that provide an opportunity to set up a social enterprise? Maybe looking at Ken, maybe in the foyer, to provide that initial advice. Because, I mean,
yes.
Young people, right, from, I mean, I suspect that no school in terms of career advice offers the even a hint towards setting up social enterprise.
Mm-hmm. I'd agree with you. And I think that there's a lot of people my age that I've spoken to whose business model would have worked as a social enterprise, haven't set up a social enterprise because they don't know anything about them.
That's interesting.
Maybe I could ask Lorna, because I mean, obviously you're in Edinburgh and you're dedicated, but how many other Lornas are there around the country?
There's another social enterprise. It depends very much on the local authority's commitment to social enterprise and how important they see it in terms of their overall economic strategy. In Edinburgh, we have a huge commitment to that. And 2 years ago, they employed me as a dedicated social enterprise growth advisor, although I do see everyone from pre-start right up to growth stage. We've got social enterprise, huge social enterprise commitment in South and North Lanarkshire. And we also have commitment in Fife and also in the Scottish Borders. So again, it very much is driven by a local authority and how important they see that in terms of the overall structure of the economy or support to that. But certainly in an Edinburgh context, I see about 110 social enterprises each year, and really my role is to have a foot in both mainstream business support and also social enterprise support, and that gives social enterprises the best of both worlds. And I think that that's what we need to work towards more of, is that integration of the support that's out there. And certainly I liaise, my key to success in Edinburgh is the partnership working that we have. I work very closely with Edinburgh University and the competitions like Scottish Edge and Converge Challenge, where they're now focusing very much on a social enterprise angle, which wasn't there previously. So there's a much more interest, particularly from the university sector, graduates and students, are passionate about social enterprise, I've found, and I think that that's where the real growth will come from, in terms, very much like James, individuals who see an opportunity to set up a social enterprise in the area of expertise that they have. So that's very important. What I would like to see, I think where there is a weakness in terms of how we approach it, is how do we support communities that are very disadvantaged, to grow those individuals that Joanne was talking about. How do we support those individuals? Because what Brian is saying is absolutely right. It's an individual that's passionate, that wants to change the world, that wants to make a difference, that drives social enterprise. It's not like someone saying, oh, there's a need, I'm going to set up a social enterprise to address that market opportunity. They're there to address a social need. And it is all about individuals who will drive that. So I would like to see more support for communities and to build more social enterprises in more disadvantaged areas. And I think that's where maybe the gap is. But we need to be much more joined up in terms of the support, because there's lots of support out there. But we do need to work more closely together.
Okay. Brian?
There is lots of support out there for anybody who wants to start a social enterprise. And if you simply Google it, they'll all come up. Scottish Government funds Just Enterprise, and in the Highlands and Islands, HiSES delivers that and effectively enables any organisation who's out there to come to Just Enterprise to ask for any kind of business advice connected to either starting or growing or developing their business one way or another. And I accept it will vary from one area to another. And business advisors vary from one area to another. Sometimes you like them, sometimes you don't. But we've got, it's there. But the big thing about it is, if you're actually keen about starting something, you'll find out how to do it. You know, and if you ask yourself, well, how do I do it? You're probably the last person to actually start it, because the kind of person who's going to start things just gets ahead and gets them done, and you will see them coming in every day. In High Sense as well, we were talking about education. We've been into a dozen secondary schools in this last year. Social Enterprise Academy runs a scheme for developing social enterprises inside schools. High Says again is sponsors within the Catalyst program in the UHI, which is all about giving mentoring to people who want to start social enterprises and want to start businesses and so on. So there's loads of us who are out there supporting. The great thing is just to get yourself in the right mood for going out and doing it.
Sure. Okay, Audrey and then Chris.
I'd also echo that. You know, there is a lot of support out there for social enterprises, and we as an organisation have been able to benefit as being, you know, operate as a business and being recognised as that and get the support that exists there, as well as being able to take advantage of social enterprise support network. What we also do is we accommodate a lot of people who are cultural social enterprises and starting up quite often as individuals, and what they really value is not just having is having firstly someone to signpost them to where the support is, and we have the cultural enterprise has presence in some of our buildings across Scotland, which is a great support for them, but also that mentoring from other social enterprises is something that shouldn't be undervalued, to understand, well, how do you do it? There are models out there that exist in other parts of Scotland to run these services in local areas, and I think what is an amazing part of coming to the social enterprise scene is that there are amazing networks all over Scotland, and they're completely invaluable. People share their time very freely, the advice is there, and people are quite happy to share that, more so than you would find probably in the slightly commercial business sector. And I think it's that just signposting, giving support to you know, funding mentoring. We're looking at graduate support all over Scotland at the moment, you know, for people who have trained in creative industries but come out of university, don't know where the first place to go, where to support, and end up just working in a coffee shop or going to going down to London or wherever. And I think it's signposting, make the legitimacy of social enterprises now is now there in the census, and I think that's been a fantastic element of the census. We were able to put that page across and say, well, this is what the sector is about, this is who we are, don't underestimate our role in the Scottish economy, and that more people can be a part of that. And I think it's signposting, providing that support and mentoring.
See, before Chris comes in, you mentioned graduates in university.
Yes.
Does that also apply to colleges?
Yes, absolutely. Okay. We've been funded by the Scottish Cities Alliance to look at Perth, Stirling and Inverness, and looking at retaining creative talent in all of those cities, because they're finding that the talent comes through the colleges and universities and leaves because there isn't a collaborative supportive network there to enable them to either learn from other people who've been through the process, set up their own, whether social enterprise or business, and they tend to gravitate to where the kind of majority of their kind of sector is, which is either Central Belt or London.
Okay, thank you. Chris?
Just to take it back just a step, I don't think the question is where is the support to do this, you know, and such forth. I think the real question is, at what point, when somebody says, you know what, I'm going to set up a business and I want to do this and I want this to happen from that, what's the first thing they do? Maybe they ask the next door neighbour that's already got a business, you know, and the next door neighbour says, okay, yeah, you need to go to Business Gateway and you can set up a limited company, you can do this, that, and other. How many next door neighbours do you think in the world will say, actually, you know what, you know, there's about 7 different models of businesses you could set up, and if you go to Business Gateway, and then when you go to Business Gateway, when we get there, what's the first thing the Business Gateway advisor might say? Probably not. Have you thought about social enterprise to get to where you want to be? Have you thought about a kick type 3 limited by shares, where you can pull in a bit of investment, you know, and it's all possible, you know? Or have you thought about this model or that model? No. There's a piece where there needs to be, people need to realise that is an option, you know, not that the option is we set up a limited company or I'm a sole trader or whatever, because within that conversation at the moment, you won't hear social enterprise mentioned. That's where you need to be. You know, because there are people out there that want to do it, but a lot of them just don't even realise they can, or know that it's available, or know that that's actually how they want to do it. So lots more loaners, and a bit more push at the front end for loaners as well.
Okay. Can I mean, we've got about 20 minutes left. I want to raise another issue that we haven't touched on really, which is the question of funding. And you know, you just mentioned this in passing, Chris, but I mean, how difficult is it in the current climate for social enterprises to access external funding sources?
What type of funding sources would you like to?
Right, isn't it? I mean, equity funding, bank funding, right, crowdfunding,
okay,
anything.
Okay, all right. Okay. I mean, the landscape is changing a little bit. I can certainly tell you about my experiences. As a CIC limited by shares, when we formulated in 2012, we went and asked the bank for a bit of money. They laughed at us and said, no thanks. How are we going to secure anything against anything at all? No chance, not whatsoever, you know. You've got an asset lock, you've got this disillusion clause, you've got all the rest of it. We don't understand what that is, but we think what that means is whatever happens, we will never get our money back if something goes wrong. So no is the answer. So then we went and tried some other people at the other end of the scale, who all kind of looked at us and looked down the nose and said, you're not a real social enterprise, are you? You're not the real deal. No, you might get some money from us and you'll steal it. So we're not going to give it you. Yeah, because you're going to pull it out as shares, etc. I think now there's a bit of a sea change. There are funding bodies out there that do great work. Some of them are limited to where they can do great work. Actually, I don't know how, but they are. And I think that, you know, there's an opportunity to open that up. I think there are now private investors coming into the realm, and for private investors, it is quite an appealing sort of proposition to have a CIC and CITAR as tax relief sat together. It gives them a great opportunity to put money into things, and the benefits are great for them there. I think it's important when we look at external investment, we move away from this grant funding stuff, definitely. There's a definite need for loan funding. That's great, because that loan funding money gets recycled, you know, and it grows slightly. You know. But yeah, it's shifting. It is moving, but we could do with pushing it a bit more.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody else want to comment on this? Sorry, Audrey, yeah.
Again, our organisation's been around for a long time. It's 39 years old, 40 next year, which will be a big milestone. But it started as a trust and, you know, developed into a social enterprise model, but, you know, relied very much on grant funding to get it to where it is today. It's at a position where, we had to form a CIC to be able to borrow. And I think just developing an asset base and looking at what your strengths are, we've been able to borrow and to support what we do, but we do rely for anything new we do, any new buildings or any expansion of what we do have to very much rely on other sources of funding. And we understand that public sector grants are drying up quite quickly. You know, we do rely on trusts and foundations, being very successful, and there are a good number of foundations and trusts that do support social enterprise specifically. Robertson Trust, for example, is one, Paul Hamlin another. But we're now having to look at, you know, how we change our model, how we change our business model, and how we structure ourselves. And there is a lot more time and energy having to be put into the business in terms of sourcing other funding. And that's everything from sponsorship to philanthropic giving to private investors. And those are very time consuming in particular, the latter two. But they're something that we know it's important to move to, and probably we have something that some investors are interested in, and you know, we can sell. But it's a mind shift to think that you have to go out and sell your organisation in a different way. And I think it was one of the comments earlier that Brian mentioned about being a slave to grants. Absolutely. Some of the public grants we're going for at the moment, we've had to write three different business plans for the same project to meet three different types of funders' requirements. And it's time consuming, it's costly. And, you know, smaller organisations, we're not at a scale that we can perhaps do that, but it still takes away a lot of core time from your core business. But for smaller organisations, you know, grant fundraising is costly, and it's time consuming, and it's frustrating. And if there's other ways of doing it, then obviously, you know, having an asset base to move forward with is something obviously we strove to achieve. And now 98% of our income is from our asset base.
Check.
Yeah, just to support that. I mean, before I came to this august place, I got involved in company turnarounds and starting up small businesses and also social enterprises. And there has been a quite significant shift in some of the funding sources. I mean, I think the phrase ethical investment is becoming more and more
dominant in discussions that you have with funders. I mean, there's also, you have Social Investment Scotland, which of course is falls into that category, I would suggest. But there is no question that in terms of the investment regime, whether it's angels or even banks, now consider, not in all cases, but in some cases, the efficacy of their investment. And that, I think that phrase, we have to keep promoting that as what we mean by investment, particularly in the social enterprise and third sector areas.
Okay. Fraser?
I think we have to be careful again. I mentioned it earlier about confusing funding investment as the same amorphous blob of money. There are some clear things that we need to be focused on. If there is a programme of grant funding, it needs to be very specifically targeted. It cannot be a general fund, and we've had general funds over the last few years, because what we've actually started to develop is a very, I think, creative and innovative social investment scene in Scotland. If we simply put in a very blanket grant programme such as the Enterprise Ready Fund or the Enterprise Growth Fund without it being specifically targeted, and there was an element of that with the previous part, but perhaps not specific enough, it then destroys the social investment capacity, because no one will go near social investment whilst there's free money available. That free money should certainly be part of the journey. It should not be part of the sustainability. But there are some other issues that come into the social investment arena. State aids legislation becomes a problem for organisations when seeking social investment. We talk about, and Chick has mentioned there, a whole range of people, whether it be Triodos Bank, Unity Trust Bank, Co-op Bank, or Charity Bank. All of them offer funds, but none of them will go under £250,000. If Social Investment Scotland have got to get involved in the arena when they're lending between £10,000 and £50,000, they've got to do it at 8%. Resilient Scotland, 6.5%. When you're crowding out that investment by not creating a competitive arena, there is an assumption that there's an absolute market failure in money. It's not. It's the price of money. It's the availability of money. It's the terms under which that money is available. So we need to get clearer about what the horse is required for the course and make sure that the things actually fit with each other rather than crowd each other out.
Sure. Brian?
I was involved in the finance industry for 15 years before I came into a social enterprise. And the interesting thing, therefore, is that I understand the language. And we found ourselves in a position that a building came up that we were interested in buying. We'd never borrowed anywhere before. We hadn't had grants before. But we had a history of being able to produce a set of accounts that looked respectable. We were able to phone the Royal Bank, the world's biggest social enterprise. We were able to phone them up about 10 o'clock on a Monday morning. He came at 20 to 5, and by 20 past 5, he said, "Do you know, I think we will probably lend you this money. The money is there. It's about knowing how to speak to the lenders. It's about knowing the products that are there. Do I use short-term borrowing for a building? No, I don't. Do I use an overdraft for a building? No, I don't. Do I buy cars and pay cash? No, I don't." It's about knowing all of those things. And again, we're in that position of running really small social enterprises who suddenly get a pile of cash, and they don't know that you actually don't spend the cash buying a van. You lease your van. It's about knowledge. It's about the sort of thing that Lorna can tell you if you know that Lorna is the person to go and speak to. So I don't think there's any shortage of money out there, but there is a shortage of knowledge on the part of those directors and managers of organisations.
Chris?
Just coming back to sort of like kick them to buy shares and sit there and such forth, you're absolutely right. Absolutely right. I would challenge anybody to pull up a raft of social enterprises that sit in that remit that are looking for investment, and get them to stand in front of somebody that is willing to invest. And there are people out there that are willing to invest on that level and say, this is what you're going to put in, this is how the system works, this is what you're going to get out, this is your exit plan. That's what we're offering, and this is where we're going to take it. Most social enterprises aren't in a position to do that. Yeah, kick limited by shares with a sit-out option. If that's what they are and that's where they're looking, they need to be able to do that. They need to be able to stand up and say, here it is, you know. And there needs to be, again, I keep coming back to it, but again, it's a piece of education to teach these people along the timeline. Like Brian says, you know, this is how these things are done. this is where you need to do. And that's done quite well within the private business sector. Yeah, all that sort of stuff's done very well within the private business sector, but we don't do it very well throughout social enterprise.
James,
points, but I think something that's interesting is that Jonathan from Social Value Labs this morning said that he thinks social enterprise startups are more successful than your traditional private limited companies. And that sort of sparked a question in my head. Is that because these social enterprises are more risk averse and aren't attempting as, you know, advanced technological innovation than the private limited companies? And if so, I believe that's the case. And if so, is that because they're not able to raise the funds to do that kind of research and development for these really, really innovative social solutions? So there's, I think it comes back again to this voluntary code for social enterprises, which I've mentioned a few times today. And a CIC limited by shares, by definition, is not part of that code, unless I've interpreted it wrong. I just wonder if there's consensus around the room that perhaps there needs to be a revision of the code. Can you make decisions that roundtable discussions like this?
Well, we're not here to make decisions. We have no particular authority to do that, but it'd be interesting to get people's views around the table of whether there was a consensus view. Brian, because you first.
ISAS was the first community interest company in Scotland, and it was the first one that was limited by shares. And I would agree with you. It's really horrible to feel that we're excluded. We just don't fit that model at all. And yet I think the three of us, it's fairly obvious that we actually understand how enterprise works. And if you're going to use the word enterprise, then use all of the other things that come along with it. So I think we should be discussing it.
Okay. Chris?
I won't worry about the code. It's voluntary. It's not compulsory.
These grant-making organisations do subscribe to the code and do not give money to companies that are limited by shares, regardless of the social purpose. I think when you look at a company and you want to decide whether it's a social enterprise, the first thing you should look at is the business model and the social impact. The legal structure should come secondary, in my opinion. I mean, it's just my opinion, and it's up for debate, of course, but I think that's what we need to be doing.
Totally in agreement.
Ken?
I think it is worth doing these kind of things, because I think what I've seen over the last 10, 20 years is the visibility of social enterprise soar. And I think through increased visibility, whether that's through the code, whether that's through the awards that Social Enterprise Scotland do, whether that's through targets within procurement arrangements, if we can find ways that increase the visibility of social enterprise, I think that will go some way to increase the amount of people that are aware of it.
Simon?
About the voluntary code of practice, I mean, if the grant-giving organisations are giving grants to organisations that describe themselves as social enterprises, and you don't want grants anyway, it's not a massive problem.
What's your point?
Well, you were saying that the grant-giving organisations are giving grants to social enterprises under the SenseCart code, but you're also saying you don't want grants. Is that right?
Well, we could definitely do with grants. I just think these grants need to be targeted to enterprises that potentially have high growth potential. And I would classify ours as one of them.
I misunderstood you earlier then.
Okay.
No problem. Chris, sorry, you want to come back in?
Yeah. On the grant thing, I think really, you know, everybody would like a grant. I just think it's where does the grant go? So I think really, you know, if you're going to hand out grants, let's make sure they're targeted to something that creates growth, that creates something that moves along, you know, not something that sustains something that's just faltering along. First and foremost, but when we come back, and just shifting back to James's point, you were talking about these social enterprises and how robust they are as startups and such forth. I think the census has been great. I think there's a lot of extra questions within the census that need to be asked, and I think on that point, one of the questions is how many of these social enterprise startups are a spin out of a charity or another organisation or such forth, and that sustains them.
Fraser.
James, the voluntary code of practice is, as Chris has mentioned, it's voluntary. It's a set of values and a set of behaviours. Social Enterprise Scotland are supporters of the code, but we're not subscribers to the code because we ourselves are not a social enterprise in the definition of the code. We have, I think, Chris, well, Brian, sorry, you were a board member of SES, but we have three or four board members of Social Enterprise Scotland who are community interest companies limited by shares. The intention is not to build a fortress around the code. It's intended to be a benchmark by which we build bridges out from the code to try and make sure that anyone who wishes to participate in the social enterprise arena can do so in a way that allows them to do that. The code is not, Simon, if I understand it rightly, the code is not SendScot's code. I understand that the code is owned by the subscribers to the code, and that's a group of social enterprise. It sits on the SendScot website, but there is a review group who looks at that on a regular basis, and I think every year they look at it in March of each year. But I'm happy, James, to have dialogue with them around that on the basis of the comments that you've made. We are not part of that review process, but I'm happy to pick up on that.
Sorry, just to reboot Simon's comment again, I was talking about a grant culture, like dependency. We just need a grant to start up, and then we will be financially sustainable, and we will not need to take on any further grants once we're financially sustainable. And I think that's perhaps the difference in where the misunderstanding arose.
Okay. Partly right, to reboot my own point. I think organisations, kicks limited by share are great. I think some voluntary organisations that will never make money from trading are great as well. And I just think there needs to be a blended funding arrangement that suits all organisations. I think there's fantastic support for graduates coming from different universities to set up really interesting social enterprises that might have been private companies in the past. But I also think that it needs targeted support for deprived areas in the east of Glasgow where they will never go to university.
Okay.
All right, Lewis.
That's been a very interesting part of the discussion, and I'm just interested to hear from some of the longer established social enterprises which are not following the. We've heard from the KIC model and some of the issues around that. Is there anything else before we close for the longer established model, company limited by guarantee and other types, where there's a change in legislation or regulation that would be particularly helpful in the next period?
I just think about this, and you know, looking at, we've got the business pledge, which covers, you know, this is how many parameters. But we've had the Procurement Act, we've had the Community Empowerment Act, and coming back to the point that Simon made, having been involved in this area for too many years, but if you go into some of the deprived areas, the great ideas, some, you know, young people with great ideas that you can't. Either because of funding in the past or what have you. You know, and there might be an argument for saying, you know, there should be an incorporation of something in the business pledge, particularly in the public sector, in terms of procurement, to say, look, you have to give a consideration to the community impact of the issuance of contracts. Now, you know, I don't like prescribing too many ideas either for any enterprise and social enterprises, but, you know, to really kick things off, that might be a solution. And I'll probably have John Swinney at the door in a minute. But anyway.
Can I also, it's a point that Ken Milroy made earlier in terms of sustainability of some of the work programmes that actually go on at provider service that's based on a year-on-year contract, because the maybe it's a local authority, are saying, well, actually, we can do this for a year. Would it not be more sensible to have something like a minimum 3 years? Because if it's year on year, surely you're coming towards the end of that year. You're looking at maybe submitting another application to say we need the funding to continue this work and all that sort of stuff. Whereas if you've got a 3 year contract, you're actually concentrating more on the delivery of service.
I couldn't agree more that we need knowledge about what procurers' plans are, what the commissioning arrangements are. So as we get towards the end of any contract, to be honest, we need positive engagement with the commissioners. I fully understand the constraints that could be on the public purse, but it's important that we have dialogue in terms of managing that change, and we will manage the change. Short-term contracts do present us with real problems in terms of securing staff and retaining staff if all you're guaranteeing is a one-year contract. So I do think there's something that could happen there. In terms of the comment that Lewis made about the structures that perhaps more established social enterprises have adopted. I think it served us well. I do think it has presented us with some particular issues, and those issues have been where things aren't working out. I've said in my evidence, we've run some business activities that weren't successful. We've had to close businesses, and making some of those difficult business decisions, which we have to make, can cause problems in terms of governance. They have tax implications. So I'm not sure if there's legal changes that would need to be made, but there is necessary that legal and financial expertise is available where you are facing those particular challenges. And they leave you with some constraints, I would say. So in terms of a successful organisation, I think in terms of activity, you know, it does present us with some financial constraints because we had loss-making businesses that we had to close. So we have to carry the loss within our overall accounts.
Okay. We're effectively at the end of our time, so I'm just going to say to people, if there are any points you're keen to make, either on this issue or any other issue, now is the time, because we're going to close very soon. Audrey.
I just want to make some comments on what Lewis raised there. Firstly, you know, if you're looking at what the committee can achieve, I think firstly the visibility of the sector. As you said, when you're in the sector, you know that all the support is there. But if you're not in the sector and you're just the person in that deprived community with an idea, you don't really know where to go. So I think the visibility of the sector is important. We get brought in quite a lot to local authorities to say, well, we've got this idea, we've had someone try it, but they've not maybe had the right model. Can you come and advise us? So that whole idea about mentoring and social enterprises mentoring and giving that support, and looking at the models that we've that have been tried and tested and rolling those out into other communities, not necessarily for us to do, but for others to learn from and adopt, is an important thing. I think, you know, grants have had their place, and I think they're still important in some of the most deprived communities. They are essential to get targeted attention, and so don't underplay that they will always have a role in some form or another. But the other thing we should be thinking about again is the investment, and social investment bonds are something that's been investigated down south, and I think perhaps is something that we could consider up here.
Okay, good, excellent. Any other final points anybody wants to make? We covered the ground. Okay, well, that's been excellent. Thank you all very much for coming along this morning and helping the committee. We have another evidence session next week on employee engagement. And at this point, I think we will suspend and go into private session. Thank you.